back in my garden. Lots more things to show you. Last time we focused mainly on perennial vegetables. This time there are some more perennial vegetables to see, but also other things, including herbs and flowers, both planted and self-sown. There are lots of different kinds of perennial onion, and this is one of them. I know it as Minogue's onion, because I got it off a gardener who got it off her Uncle Fred, whose surname was Minogue. That's all I know about it. And it's a good winter salad onion. At this time of year, it's halfway between its winter form and its summer form. In the winter, you get fairly narrow bulbs, which you can pull out and have as salad. In the summer, the bulbs swell up and about that sort of size, and you can use them for cooking. And the leaves die right down in summer. Now, in April, it's about sort of halfway between the two stages. Anyway, it's quite, to harvest it, you need to pull up the whole bunch, as I have, and then you cut it off, cut off the root, cut off the stem, and that's the edible part. Trim it a little bit more, because it's only the bulb that's edible. And then these little ones, you put those back in the ground so they can grow again for next year. It's a really useful year-round onion for salad in the winter and cooking in the summer. And here you see it in its springtime form, where it's really halfway between the two. And here we have another member of the onion family, wild garlic, which I expect a lot of people are familiar with. A wonderful wild plant, which grows really well in the shade. And this is one of the shadiest parts of the garden, and it does very well here. It's even spreading, you see, little ones coming up here. And what I'm gonna do, I mean, this bit of the garden is very shady. It's not very productive for annual plants. And so I'm gonna let this become a perennial area. With the wild garlic, it's a real hungry gap plant. The hungry gap in the spring, when there's not much to eat from the annual garden, wild garlic is at its best. And then it dies down in about June. So I need something else to take over from then. So what I'll probably do here is introduce nasturtiums, which are another lovely salad plant, not perennial in our climate, but a brilliant self-seeder. So you've got one for the early part of the year and another for the later part of the year. And also behind me here, this is a small blackcurrant plant that someone gave me last year, and I just popped it in here because I couldn't really think of what to do with it. And as you can see, there's not nearly enough space for it here. A blackcurrant plant will grow far bigger than this. So what I've decided to do is that next winter, I'm going to transplant it into the middle of this space with the wild garlic and the other plants. And so this will, what you'll have here will be a currant bush in the middle and perennial vegetables all around underneath it, including this little one here, which is muskmallow, which you may remember from the last film. Also, we've got a little self-sown flower here, and I don't know what it is. It's something which has come in from some other garden. I'm pretty sure it's some kind of oxalis, looking at the leaves, but I don't mind what it is. It's pretty, and I'll leave it there because it'll brighten the place up. And over on the other side, we've got a whole lot more self-sown flowers. This little patch here is a flower bed, and we've planted all sorts of things here over the years, but this year the columbines have moved in. Now, columbine is a self-seeder in this garden. It pops up all over the place anyway, but this time it's decided to come and completely colonize our little flower bed. So that's going to be fantastic. I love columbine. It's such a pretty little flower. I'm told it's edible, but I've never eaten it because I value it more for its decorative value. Another plant, a native local plant that self-seeds all over the place around here, is primrose, and it does very well in this garden. And it's one of those lovely gentle plants which self-seeds enough but not too much. You know, I've hardly ever had to take one out because it's in the way of something else. And in amongst the primroses, we have a chives plant, and that's just one of the herbs that we've got in the garden. And so we've got all sorts of things popping up here and there, and there's a welcome for all of them. This is a mint, and you may well be able to see that it's actually planted in a plant pot which has been sunk into the ground, and the idea of that is it stops it spreading. In fact, it's not 100%. You know, mint is a terrible spreader, but this one's planted in an odd corner of the garden where it can't really do much harm. But what a wonderful thing to have, mint. You can use it in so many different ways, in salads and cooked dishes and so forth, and as tea, of course. Excellent plant, as long as you make sure that it's not somewhere where it will matter if it spreads. And then the next plant, just beyond the little lantern, is garlic cress. Now, some people recommend growing garlic mustard or jack by the hedge, which is a native plant, which has a similar taste to this one, but it's not very good. It's only really edible for a very short window in the year, around about Easter time, whereas this one is edible pretty well throughout the year. And quite attractive purplish leaves in the spring, and as you would expect, a flavour that is somewhere between garlic and cress. And then moving on a little bit further, there's a bit of a gap, and we come to marjoram. Excellent plant, and very good for dishes based on squash, but it will go with all sorts of things, and it's not too strong. You can use it in lots of ways, particularly in dishes based on squash. You can use it in salads as well. Now, this plant has been going for a long time. Eventually, it will need replacing. And there's a little space just to the left of it where there's nothing growing at the moment, and I think I might plant another one there. You see, these herbs are growing just on the top of this tiny little wall, and that's what they like. They like really good drainage, almost all of the herbs. And we'll see that a little bit more when we go on to the next plant, which is a savory. Excellent plant, savory. Goes with almost everything. And this one needs a little bit of a prune. You can prune herbs at any time when they're not flowering. This one's still got a lot of last year's stems on it, which will get in the way when we try and pick the leaves. So I'm just giving it a bit of a shear. Make picking nice and easy for this year. Next are two thymes, my favourite herb, thyme. Always put it in an omelette. And the thing about thyme is it's a very small plant, especially if you're picking it, and so you need more than one of them. I've got two here. In fact, I had four. Two died last winter. Good job I had four. I mean, a terrible winter for herbs. Wet, they don't like the wet. That's why I got them on top of this little wall. And so anyway, I've still got enough thyme with two plants. Now, when it comes to the larger plants, as we have here, the boot's on the other foot. What we've got here is rosemary and sage. Now, we used to have a sage plant over there that was about that big. And every year we would pick and pick and pick, and every year it would grow that big again. Now, in a small garden like this, you don't want to devote that amount of space to something that you only use in very small quantities. On the whole, growing things in pots is more difficult than growing things in the open ground. But the aromatic herbs are an exception to that, because the main reason why it's more work growing things in pots is because they dry out so quickly. Now, these herbs actually not only tolerate dry soil, they actually prefer it, and they give more of their aromatics, more of their essential oils when they're slightly stressed for moisture during the summer. So we've got these here in the pots, and that's restricting their size, but we still get enough and really tasty. There's quite an interesting comparison here, actually, between these two sages. This is an ordinary culinary sage. This one is a flowering sage, and it's pretty well dead. Now, you may think that's, oh, it's the competition from these plants that are growing there. It's not, actually. It's the other way around. herbs, aromatic herbs, are quite good at controlling weeds because they give off chemicals, probably the same chemicals that we value them for, which inhibit the germination of weeds. And this one, because it's dying, is not got any leaves anymore. It's not giving out those chemicals anymore. And so everything is growing underneath. Very interesting that, how it's often so easy to confuse cause and effect. And finally, the apples. And here we have them. The only fruit trees I've got in this garden is a couple of pears, but the apple trees are in another plot a little bit further away. And I've got apples right throughout the season, from middle of September right through to May. These are the late keeping variety, Pixie. I really recommend it. Easy to grow, no problem with pests and diseases, and keeps that long. And good taster too, nice and crisp. You get the occasional one that rots in store, like the proverbial bad apple. Just need to remove those, put them in the compost heap. And there you have it. We get food almost throughout the year from our garden. I mean, you know, not by means, any means everything that we eat, but a proportion of it, and as much as we can grow on this small space.